Well, welcome here to St. David's. Nice to have you. You may be seated. If you're wondering about the flowers in front of you, they're from Jean Hibbs' family. Her funeral is on Friday. Our introit by the choir is, O Christ, you wept when grief was raw. And that is found on 604, if you would like to look along at the words.
Limited only in our own capacity to see and understand. Help us to recognize your guiding, comforting presence, digging deeper into our Christian journey to understand the meaning of Christ's incarnation. In his name we pray. Amen.
Let's sing together number 990 in the Book of Praise, Up from the Depths, I Cry to God. I believe this is a rendition of Psalm 130. 90. Let's sing together.
Physically with the plants and the trees and the outdoor
all the things that are outdoors. Lord, we thank you as we look up into the sky and see the stars and the planets, where we see the vastness of your universe, we recognize again you as the God over all. We also recognize you, God, as the one who touches each one of us, who knows us by name, who knows what we are doing, who knows our attitudes, who knows all that is within us. And so we come into that place safely to confess our sins to you, not to come in to be judged, but rather to turn them over to you that we might know your assurance, your pardon, and your love anew. And so we quietly confess our sins to the Lord. We thank you that in Jesus Christ we can know your love, a love anew. Forgive us where we have not loved one another. Forgive us where we have not shown your truth and love to others around us. Forgive us where we are centered sometimes more in ourselves than on you and your ways, listening to you and what you have to say. And Lord, we thank you for that prayer that you gave us as a community to desire your ways and will to be our ways and will, to your practice where you are to be our practice here. And so we say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Choir will now lead us in an anthem, Bless Us This Day. Hymn, and at 6:31, Jesus' hands were kind hands. So look along with your parents if you're able to. 631, 631 in the Book of Praise.
Week, and we're remembering that God loves you and that Jesus gave himself so that you could know and love God. Okay, so let's just bow our heads and say a prayer. And we're all looking forward to Palm Sunday and to Easter and Good Friday as well. You say the prayer after me, please. Dear God, thank you for your love shown to us at the cross. Help us to love you, to understand more, and know you. In Jesus' name. Amen. Bless you guys. It's good to get excited, isn't it, about going to Sunday school. And as the boys and girls are going out, I think Chris is going to come up and read for us about dem dry bones, and also from Romans chapter 8.
Good morning, everyone. Our first reading this morning is from Ezekiel, chapter 37. I'll be reading from verses 1 to 14, and you'll find this on page 1295 through 1296 in your pew Bible. This chapter is entitled The Valley of Dry Bones, and as I said, we'll begin at verse 1, chapter 37. The hand of the Lord was on me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord, and set me in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones. He led me back and forth among them, and I saw a great many bones on the floor of the valley, bones that were very dry. He asked me, "Son of man, can these bones live?" I said, "Sovereign Lord, you alone know." Then he said to me, "Prophesy to these bones and say to them, dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. This is what the sovereign Lord says to these bones. I will make breath enter you, and you will come to life. I will attach tendons to you, and make flesh come upon you, and cover you with skin. I will put breath in you, and you will come to life. Then you will know that I am the Lord." So I prophesied as I was commanded. And as I was prophesying, there was a noise, a rattling sound, and bones came together, bone to bone. I looked, and tendons and flesh appeared on them, and skin covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, "Prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, son of man, and say to it, this is what the sovereign Lord says. Come, breath, from the four winds, and breathe into these slain that they may live." So I prophesied as he commanded me, and breath entered them. They came to life and stood up on their feet, a vast army. Then he said to me, "Son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. They say, our bones are dried up, and our hope is gone. We are cut off. Therefore prophesy and say to them, this is what the sovereign Lord says. My people, I am going to open your graves and bring you up from them. I will bring you back to the land of Israel. Then you, my people, will know that I am the Lord, when I open your graves and bring you up from them. I will put my spirit in you, and you will live, and I will settle you in your own land. Then you will know that I, the Lord, have spoken, and I have done it, declares the Lord." Our second reading this morning comes from Romans, chapter 8. This is on page 1682 of your pew Bible, and we'll be reading from verses 6 through 11. So Romans 8, beginning at line 6. The mind controlled by the sinful nature is death, but the mind controlled by the Spirit is life and peace. The sinful mind is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so. Those controlled by the sinful nature cannot please God. You, however, are not controlled by the sinful nature, but are in the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God lives in you. And if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, they do not belong to Christ. But if Christ is in you, even though your body is subject to death because of sin, the Spirit gives life because of righteousness. And if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies because of his Spirit who lives in you. God grant us understanding of this, his most holy word.
And let's all turn together then over to Psalm 130, please, which is found on page 929. Psalm 130. And it's fairly short. Let's say it all together in unison. Out of the depths I cry to you, Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to my cry for mercy. If you, Lord, kept a record of sins, Lord, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness, so that we can, with reverence, serve you. I wait for the Lord. My whole being waits, and in his word I put my hope. I wait for the Lord. More than watchmen wait for the morning. More than watchmen wait for the morning. Israel, put your hope in the Lord. For with the Lord is unfailing love, and with him is full redemption. He himself will redeem Israel from all their sins. Amen. And then over to the gospel reading, once again in the Gospel of John. Continuing in our series of conversations with Jesus. This time we have the account of Lazarus. John chapter 11 and verses 1 to 45. Now a man named Lazarus was sick. He was from Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. This Mary, whose brother Lazarus now lay sick, was the same one who poured perfume on the Lord and wiped his feet with her hair. So the sisters sent word to Jesus, Lord, the one you love is sick. And when he heard this, Jesus said, this sickness will not end in death. No, it is for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified through it. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that Lazarus was sick, he stayed where he was 2 more days. And then he said to his disciples, let us go back to Judea. But Rabbi, they said, a short while ago the Jews there tried to stone you, and yet you are going back. Jesus answered, are there not 12 hours of daylight? Those who walk in the daytime will not stumble, for they see by this world's light. It is when people walk at night that they stumble, for they have no light. After he had said this, he went on to tell them, our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I am going there to wake him up. His disciples replied, Lord, if he sleeps, he will get better. Jesus had been speaking of his death, but his disciples thought he meant natural sleep. So then he told them plainly, Lazarus is dead, and for your sake I am glad I was not there, so that you may believe. But let us go to him. Then Thomas, also known as Didymus, said to the rest of the disciples, let us also go that we may die with him. On his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them in the loss of their brother. And when Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home. Lord, Martha said to Jesus, if you had been here, my brother would not have died, but I know that even now, God will give you whatever you ask. Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Martha answered, I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. Anyone who believes in me will live, even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this? Yes, Lord, she told him. I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, who has come into the world. And after she had said this, she went back and called her sister Mary aside. The teacher is here, she said, and is asking for you. When Mary heard this, she got up quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet entered the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. And when the Jews who had been with Mary in the house comforting her noticed how quickly she got up and went out, they followed her, supposing she was going to the tomb to mourn there. When Mary reached the place where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. Where have you laid him? He asked. Come and see, Lord, they replied. Jesus wept. Then the Jews said, see how he loved him? But some of them said, could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying? Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. Take away the stone, he said. But Lord, said Martha, the sister of the dead man, by this time there is a bad odor, for he has been there 4 days. Then Jesus said, did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God? So they took away the stone. Then Jesus looked up and said, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me. And when he said this, Jesus called out in a loud voice, Lazarus, come out. The dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen and a cloth around his face. And Jesus said to them, take off the grave clothes and let him go. Amen. May God help us to understand this and all that his word gives to us. Let us sing together, Jesus, Life of All the World, 776 in the Book of Praise, 776.
Source and Son of all.
may be seated. Let us pray. Help us, Lord, as we come to know and see our lives anew as you see them, to hear again your perspective on our world, on our relationships, on ourselves. Give us continually the honesty that we need, courage to be honest with you and with one another. Help us to love each other through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Well, the conversation around Lazarus brings us to a question, and a question that I'd like to ask everyone just kind of up front. Have you made your funeral plans? No doubt. Now, don't get me wrong. I'm not telling you you're going to die before next Sunday, although none of us really know. And we are getting closer to that end of the world date, have you noticed? That radio ministry in California had predicted would be May 21st, so it's good to get our things in order. And no, the funeral homes are not paying me to advertise for their services. I'm just wondering if you have had a chance or made the time to talk to anyone about what you would like for your funeral. Unfortunately, it's often only at funerals that we celebrate someone and what their life has meant to us. Too bad we don't usually sit down with them to ask them what they would like to be the center of their life, their center of what has been their life, the center of the service which celebrates their life, celebrate their lives and give glory to God. Now, when you talk about your funeral, don't think about it in terms of your death. Think about it in terms of your life. Help it to focus you. Make sure you tell your loved one what era of your life is most important to you, that someone should talk about. Make sure you tell them the music you like, or would like, or maybe would like to have, whether it's in church or somewhere else. Make sure you tell them what scriptures have touched your life, and maybe you could have them as a part of the service. Make sure you tell them what you want done with your last possession, which everyone knows is your body. I've sat down with hundreds of members of families over the years now who have been caught quite off guard in terms of what they would like to see for their services. Rarely someone leaves a long list of details that makes you wonder if they really thought they would be in control of the service even after they were gone. Usually it's the opposite. There's very little detail. And of course, again, without any advertisements for anyone, update your wills. Make sure you have one. This is just a matter of relieving others of the legal grief they might face or go through if you don't have one on file somewhere. And these matters are not just a way of talking about death. Don't hear this as talking about death. No, the will and the funeral details are about life continuing. And the recognition that our lives, our life, the life that we have is more than our own life. And now, you might be really young and saying to yourself, I don't want to do this, I don't need to do this, I've got lots of time. And all I can say is don't kid yourself. I'm sure many of us have stories as to people who have had accidents and various things. I'm sure all of us know that we can't be assured of any length of time, whether it be very short or very long. All of this is a way, not so much about focusing on that service, but it's a way to talk about the deepest things of life, the important stuff. What is your life really about? What is your passion in this life? You might be surprised how few people can answer this question for the loved one who's just passed away. I'm continually surprised. I've rarely met, if you ever want a real treat, talk to a funeral director about their spiritual life. I've rarely had a funeral director who has told me, this is what I really believe about death and afterlife. They've never thought about it. Now, you think somebody in that business would think a lot about it. So it's not just us. Maybe we haven't thought about these things. Eventually, something, of course, will be said for everyone. But these funeral questions focus the mind on what really is important and put our mortality in front of us again. Because all of us will have a funeral somewhere, sometime. The scriptural account about Lazarus does the same. It brings us and those who follow Jesus into the home of someone who has just lost someone very close to them. Mary and Martha are famous sisters who are well known to many of us. Mary stayed close to Jesus and listened, do you remember that story, to what he said, while Martha was more concerned about the housekeeping and the meal preparation. We get the impression that Mary is the spiritual one and Martha not so much. But in this encounter, we find both Mary and Martha are women who strongly trust the Lord. Martha meets Jesus first when he and his followers arrive. She says, "I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask," in verse 22. This is a statement of profound trust and faith in Jesus Christ, even in the midst of her loss. Jesus follows this statement up with a question about her believing that Lazarus, her brother, will rise again. She says, she does believe this will happen at the last day in verse 24. And in response to Martha's great faith, Jesus reveals himself as being the resurrection and the life, the one who defeats our fear of death if we will but listen to him. To which again, Martha's faith is a cameo where she speaks her faith as strongly as Peter ever did when she says, "I believe that you, Jesus, are the Messiah, Son of God, who has come into the world," verse 27. Later on, Mary echoes the exact words of Martha, "Lord, if you'd been here, my brother would not have died." That's in verses 21 and 32. Both Martha and Mary had a deep trust in Jesus. They had seen and heard what he had done in many places and with many kinds of illnesses and distresses. Jesus knew that both Martha and Mary strongly trusted him. Instead of going through the whole discussion he had had with Mary a second time, he simply asks where Lazarus's body has been laid. So they go up to where the body has been laid. And again, we have to put aside our cultural experiences of cemeteries and realize that in that place and time, many bodies were placed in caves and a large stone rolled over the opening rather than placing them in the ground in orderly, tidy plots as we do. Jesus goes near the entrance to the cave, and then we read the shortest verse in the Bible, and you all know that verse because you've all memorized it. So don't tell me you've never memorized any Bible verses, and that is, Jesus wept. Jesus wept. And from this shortest verse, I think probably technically the easiest verse to memorize, we recognize that Jesus was with Martha and Mary in their loss. And this isn't just a story about history. This is the fact that he is with us in our losses. And so all I need to say here is know that he is with you in your losses. Know that he cares whatever you are going through right now. Know that whatever you've gone through, no matter how badly you've been sinned against, no matter what pain or outrage you have experienced, Jesus is weeping with you and for you. He knows more even than we do about what we have gone through, and he is for us, not against us. All that in those two little words. Why do we have to go through the losses and difficulties and challenges that we have to go through? I don't know. I don't. But I believe he does. But I also believe he wants to hold us and love us in the midst of our losses, of our loss. And now you all know the end of the story of Lazarus, even before we read all 45 verses. Jesus asked that the stone be rolled away. And at this point, we do hear in Martha the practical side coming back out, where she says, "Lord, it will stink. His body's been there 4 days in the heat." And I take this as something like that spit test of last week. We have the stink test this week. And Jesus appears not to be too concerned about these things, but rather about the center of life and health. And I hope as you come week by week, You're concerned about the center of why we're here in terms of life and health, spiritual life and health. Jesus calls Lazarus by name. Jesus calls each one of us by name. Lazarus responds. Many of us do as well. Jesus shows he is Lord not only of healing, of the Sabbath, of spiritual encounters, but now Lord over death. It is like a small Easter event before the big Easter event. It is a sign and a wonder before the sign of signs and the wonder of wonders. It is the last major miracle Jesus accomplished in the Gospel of John before Palm Sunday in chapter 12, which is next week. There's so much life in what Jesus does. We forget we're talking sometimes when we're talking about him, that he is the creator, the life giver. The church is involved in our lives at birth and baptism, at death and funerals, at weddings and confirmations, membership celebrations, at ordinations and inductions, at the opening and closing of church buildings. Jesus has much life to transfer to us and through us. It all comes back to trusting him. We need to trust him for the big things and communicate with our loved ones about them. It's also about trusting him with the little things, like our voting for someone who will be a good leader and steward of our financial resources, our nation, our country, all the things that are important to us. And you can look on a website, this is a little commercial, you can look on a website to find out if your local candidate has agreed to make poverty reduction an important part of his or her work as an MP. And you can find that at candidatesagainstpoverty.ca. Voting mightn't be the biggest thing in our lives, and I know a lot of us feel that way. But we need to trust the Lord for our voting, for our talking, for our telling others what's important to us. We need to speak out for what we believe Jesus would want us to speak out about. He knows us as he knows and knew Mary and Martha and Lazarus. He loves us as he loved them. He's no longer physically present, so now we have to trust beyond our physical senses, something that we do all the time here when loved ones are away. But Jesus is not away, but here. Although we do not necessarily have the best scientific models for incorporating spiritual life into the other realms of our lives, nevertheless, it is there and prominent and important. Let us trust Jesus with our lives, with our death, with our losses, and with our celebrations. Let us once again invite him into every part of our lives. Let us pray. Lord, sometimes we do get scared when we think about the end of this life, whether we are young or older. Lord, you know our hearts and our minds. Guide us through our fears and anxieties to the point where we can trust you even in this most intimate part of who we are, that we might know your life now and trust you into the next life. Thank you, Lord, for these moments we can have together to talk about what's important, to again think about those things which are important to you and to one another. Help us as we seek to honor you day by day in every part of what we do and say. In Jesus' name. Amen. Lots of announcements. We did put a little summary of what happened at session. That's on the back of the question from the catechism. Also, the Holy Week services are at 7 p.m. here, starting, it's only a week Monday. Is that right? Yes. A week tomorrow? That's the 18th. It's coming up soon. So we encourage you to come out to a service, particularly if you've never been to one before. It's a good time of fellowship, and it's a good time to enjoy all that this week has for us. There will be services Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday at 7, Thursday at 6:30 and then Friday at 11 a.m. and two services of communion on Easter Sunday. So just to keep that in your mind. Also, there are the Flipper dinner is coming up soon, and there's a few jobs left still to consider. And please talk to Millie, or if you don't know who Millie is, you can call her, and I'm sure she'll be just as nice to you as she is to me on the phone. The spring newsletter is coming soon. We'd like to have everything in very, very soon. That includes my article, and I just remember Aunt Thanks, Steve. And so if you'd like to include something from your family news or something of interest to you, please do that at this time. And the May weekend just keeps creeping towards us. That is the youth weekend. The committee gets a little worried because we know there will be at least 81. So we're looking for billets for them, as most our youth can't afford to be in B&Bs or hotels or that type of thing. So if you could open your home just to one or two, that would be very nice. And again, you don't even necessarily have to have an extra bed, but we can talk about that. I think that's all for announcements. Is there anything that I've missed here? Okay. Let's have our offering at this time. If the ushers would come forward, we'd give to God our gifts, tithes, and offerings. Closing time of prayers and Thanksgiving intercession. We certainly will remember the family of Gene Hibbs at this time and many friends here. We will also continue to ask the Lord for mercy across the face of the world as we continue to pray for various countries who need God's help and intervention in so many ways. And so with this in mind, let us pray. Lord, we just take a quiet moment again to say thank you in our own way. Thank you for this life that we have. There are many things that we can choose to complain about, many things that don't go the way we expect or hope. And yet we come back to you and simply say thank you. You know our hearts and minds, our mental reflections, our people in our lives that are closest to us, who also know us quite well. We give you thanks for them. Lord, we give you thanks for all those you place in our lives day by day. Those that we expect to see, those who are surprises on the journey. Help those who are undergoing many types of loss at this time, particularly be with Jean Hibbs' family and her friends. Thank you again for all that she did here and her giving, loving spirit. Lord, we thank you as well for your caring for each one of us here. Lord, we pray just very briefly for those who are on our left and on our right. Bless them, Lord. Help them know you, love you, be their strength in crises, be in their minds and hearts as they experience joy and love and celebration. And Lord, across our earth, we ask for your mercy. In Japan, with further earthquakes and further fears about the nuclear disaster, give wisdom and discernment to those who are looking after these things. And across Africa and the Middle East, where there is unrest and difficulty, Lord, help us, Lord, to continue to pray as we read and hear the news, see the news. Allow your church to rise up with love and help and comfort in these many areas. Use us. We trust you, Lord, in these days and hours. Give us what we need to speak with those close to us about what is most important to us. Help us to pray with each other. And we give you thanks for all that's coming in Palm Sunday and Easter, Holy Week. Help us to look forward and to trust you through these special times of the year, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The closing hymn is actually a Pentecost hymn, but it seemed to go very well with the dry bones, which I didn't say anything about. But 284 is the closing hymn. Revive your work, O Lord. Be yours now and forevermore. Amen.